Hello everyone. So in this lecture, what we will be doing is we will be implementing convolutional neural network using Keras, which is a high level API on which is sitting on top of nowadays TensorFlow, and TensorFlow is sitting on top of C++. So in the TensorFlow 2 version, actually, this is basically the structure of the API. But in this lecture, what we will be doing is we will be solely using Keras and not TensorFlow.Keras. Nowadays in TensorFlow 2, Keras is inbuilt into TensorFlow. But right now in this lecture, what we will be doing is we will be focusing solely on Keras and not on this library. This library we will discuss later on. So this lecture is basically on implementing CNN using Keras, which is here. So these are the typical importing of the libraries, as we have discussed this so many times. So this is basically importing of the NumPy library. This is basically importing MNIST dataset from Keras.dataset module. This is basically importing two underscore categorical function from Keras.util module. Here we are importing the sequential model from Keras.model module. And now we are importing convolutional 2D, max pooling 2D, flatten and dense functions, which we have implemented in our earlier lecture, that is DL underscore 54. There we have implemented this by our hand, but this time what we are doing is we are importing these functions from Keras.layer. And for plotting purpose, what we are doing, we are using matplotlib.pyplot as PLT. So we will use all these functions which we are importing from these specific modules. So this is the first time we are in making use of Keras library. So I hope you will feel comfortable using all these functions, because it's very easy to work using Keras level API rather than doing it from scratch. Okay, so as we have discussed this, so let's execute this on this following Google Colab code. So this we have already discussed, so let's run this. So as you can see that the default version is switching to TensorFlow 2.x, which we will discuss somewhere in our future lecture. But for now, what I am doing is, I am focusing solely on Keras high level API and not TensorFlow.Keras API. So now we have imported the required libraries needed to run this particular experiment. One thing to correct here, that actually in between TensorFlow and C++, basically it's not C++ here, it's Python first and then C++. So it's not directly C++. It's basically the TensorFlow is on top of Python, and Python is basically on top of C++. And this, okay, so let's discuss what is the next piece of code. So in the next piece of code, what we are doing is we are exploring the MNIST data, and what we are doing, we are actually loading the data from MNIST data set, which we have already called here. And then once we call the load data function, then it will automatically load that MNIST data set into its corresponding training variables, that is x underscore train and its corresponding labels here. And similarly, the test and its corresponding test labels. So now if you want to see the size of this data set, then what we are doing is we are writing the x underscore train dot shape command here and the corresponding y underscore train shape, and similarly for the test and its corresponding label shape. So let's see this, what results we will get here. So once we execute this, what we get is it's basically downloading the data, and now you can see that the training data set is of size 60,000, and the size of the images are 28 x 28, and similarly the labels corresponding to that 60,000 images is basically of size 60,000, 1. So it's basically 60,000 labels. And similarly for the test, we have 10,000 test images and correspondingly the 10,000 labels, and the size of the images in the test data set are also 28 x 28. Okay, so now what we are doing is we are trying to see any one of the images. So we are selecting 34th image and trying to see how this image looks like. So let's execute this here. So you can see that the image looks like this. It's basically a 0 which is slanted, and the dimension of this image is also 28 x 28. Okay, so now the important part is how to reshape these images so that we can feed it into the Keras API. So what Keras expects us to input is the dimension of the image should be of the following format. That is, its dimension should be number of images, comma, its rows, comma, column, and how many dimensions that image has. So in this format, we want our images to be reshaped so that it can be fed into the Keras API. So the number of images that we are feeding here should be present here, the rows and the columns of that image, and this is the dimension, which is 1 in case of grayscale image and 3 in case of RGB images. So here what we are doing is, now we are reshaping the train data set, which is earlier of dimension 28 cross 28, and what we are doing, we are reshaping it by using dot reshape command. And you can see here that the first argument here is basically x underscore train dot shape 0, which will return 60,000. So this means we have 60,000 images, which is basically num underscore image, and then its corresponding dimensions, which are 28 and 28, which are the rows and columns of this image. And this is basically 1 because we are dealing with grayscale images. Similarly, for the test images, we will write over here. And you can see the corresponding dimensions of the train and the test, which are modified by using these two commands. So let's see that. Once you run this block of code, what you see is the dimension of the train and test images being modified to this. First value represents the number of images in the training data set and its corresponding dimensions. And here this represents the grayscale image. Similarly, for the test image, the dimension is here. And if you see earlier, xtrain and the corresponding x underscore test has this dimension, which is 60,000, 28, 28, 10,000, 28, 28. But there was no fourth argument. And that fourth argument is basically the channel that we are fusing here. Okay, so the next thing is the data scaling and normalization. And this is basically done to make our algorithm run faster. So what we are doing here, we are actually first converting it into the float 32 data type. And then we are doing similarly for x underscore test also. And then what we are doing, we are normalizing it by 255 and 255, and then subtracting 0.5 from it so that it will be uniformly distributed around 0. So this we have already done in our earlier piece of code also, that is in DL underscore 54. You can watch that. So we are making our data normalization and scaling similar to what we have done over here, in order to compare these two programs on similar type of data. Okay, so the next thing is to create a sequential model for the CNN in Keras. Actually, in Keras, we can have two types of models. One is sequential model and another one is functional model. We will discuss these two models in detail in some other lecture, but for now, we will be focusing more on sequential model. So the number of filters that we are using in case of our convolutional neural network is 8 here. And the size of the filters in the CNN are basically 3 cross 3. And the pool size, that is the pooling filter, that is the filter that we are using in max pool layer, are of size 2 cross 2. So now this statement is basically calling a sequential model, which is over here. And then what we are doing, we are adding layers by layers into this model by using dot add command. So as we know that the CNN has convolution layer first, followed by pooling layer, and followed by that we have flattening of the layer, and then it's basically connected to dense layer. So this is basically the typical interconnection of the blocks in CNN. So what we are doing, we are actually adding these blocks one by one. So as you can see, first of all we have added a convolutional block, followed by the max pooling block, followed by the flattened block, and then followed by the dense block. The convolutional 2D block requires the number of filters as first of the arguments, its corresponding size as the second argument, and the stride as the third argument, and the shape as the fourth argument. So we are providing it here. In the max pooling block, it requires the filter size or the filter dimension as first argument, so we are putting it here. In order to flatten, what you do is you just call the flatten function with no argument here, and then this flatten function is connected to the dense layer with 10 outputs, and the activation layer that we are using at the output is the softmax. So this is the typical way of writing the sequential model. So once we have defined the model, now the next step is to compile the model. So in order to compile the model, what we are doing is we are calling this dot compile command, and we are using Adam optimizer here, with the loss as categorical underscore entropy loss, which is basically used for evaluating the loss. And the metric that we are using in order to evaluate the model is basically the accuracy. Now, once we have compiled the model, then we will train the model. And by training the model means we will use dot fit command here. And what we will be feeding there is the training data set, its corresponding labels. And you can see that I am using two underscore categorical function. What this will do is it will convert the training variables into one hot encoded vector. So now, right now in our y underscore train, we have labels running from 0 to 9. So what two underscore categorical will do is it will convert this 0 into a vector of dimension 10 cross 1 with 1 at the 0th location and the rest are all 0. And similarly, it will convert any training label having 8 as the value to a 10, a 1 cross 10 vector with 1 at the 8th location and the rest of them will be all 0. So it's basically an automatic way of converting into one hot encoded vector the value that you will pass over here. For the validation, we will be using the test data set, and correspondingly, we will provide its labels also by using two underscore categorical function applied to test labels. And we are running it for three epochs, and verbos is equal to 1 for display purpose. So once we have this, let's execute this block of code. So we have discussed this, so let's run this. Now we have defined the sequential model also, so let's execute this also. So this is also executed. We have discussed these two commands also, so let's run this. So once we run this, you can see that our code will start training the model. So you can see the training is started and it's calculating the loss and its corresponding accuracy for first epoch. This is for the second epoch. And see the speed. It's fast compared to the code that we have developed from scratch. And the reason for that is that all the libraries that we are calling, like Con2D, MaxPooling, and even the flatten layer and dense layer, they are all optimized and written in a very well optimized version. Whereas in our case, we wrote these codes in a non-optimized version. That's why the speedup that we obtained through Keras library is much higher than that of what we had implemented in our earlier lectures. So you can see that the accuracy for this particular model is 96% and the loss is 0.11%. And this is for the test data set. Whereas in case of training data set, we are obtaining this loss and its corresponding accuracy here.
So now once our model is trained, so the time has come to test the images on our trained network. So for that, what we are doing now is we are doing the task of prediction here. So this is basically the task of prediction that is going on. And here what we are doing, we are actually calling this function that is model.predict. And we are doing it on 5 test images and calculating the prediction out of it. And once we calculate the prediction, then we will be printing the maximum value of the prediction vector that we are obtaining on axis 1. So what that means is, I will show you when we will be doing the simulations. So what it will do is, it will print the prediction of the model that we have trained. So once that is done, what we can do is we can check this result, which we'll be obtaining from here, with that of the original labels that we have for the image. And that is printed through using print y_test:5. So it will print the labels of the first 5 images. So we can compare this and see if there is any discrepancy. So let's run this piece of code. So once we run this, you can see that we are getting vectors of predictions. So it's a 1 cross 10 vector, and you can see there are 5 such vectors. So whatever is the maximum value from this particular vector, what it will do is, this will actually print the index of that maximum value. So the maximum value in this particular vector comes at 7, so it will print out the 7th location. So basically np.argmax is printing the location of the maximum value for a particular vector. So for the second vector here, it's printing 2, means the maximum value is occurring at second location. For the third, the maximum value is occurring at first location, and for the fourth, it's at 0, and for the fifth, it's at 4. So when we print the prediction of the trained model, it's coming as 7, 2, 1, 0 and 4. And when we print the corresponding test labels for the test images that we have fed into this model.predict, we are getting 7, 2, 1, 0 and 4. So you can see there is no discrepancy here, and so whatever we predicted, that is 7, 2, 1, 0, 4, is actually the labels of that corresponding image. So this is all related to convolutional neural networks. In the next lecture series, we will start working with some other architecture. Till then, thanks for watching my lecture. See you next time.